comments on technical problems.
The projector and the laptop have stopped talking to each other, so
that's what we're waiting for now.
Pictures of the properties,
Well, while we know about the evolution of the morphing single strand, it was here. But the plants are there, they say, once they go around the screen sequence, the evolution is mostly at a constant velocity. We go to the red supergiant phase. In this phase, they are expected to lose as much as one half of the initial mass. And then we will go backwards to hotter temperatures, going through the thermobaryon phase and don't know where it goes on. But the problem is that during this evolution, this stars encounter two instability regions. First one is called the yellow void. This region. And here, it's a region where the thermobaryons, they reach this border. The effective gravity on the side of the photosphere of the star, it has extremely low, even negative. So any movement outwards will be accelerated, so we have an ejection of material. This ejection of material will result in a thick wind that would then make the star look colder, and then the star will move here and then move back. This was called the bouncing against the yellow void. It has been observed for several objects. It's a broadcast. We observed several times. But well, in the meantime, while the photosphere is ejecting this material, the star itself continues to go to higher temperatures, and once it's crossing this instability region, then it's fighting another one. Which is called this instability of the luminous variables. As you see here, when the yellow habilian start, you see luminous variables. This is because when the yellow habilian starts to cross, the yellow one is just here. It would enter directly into this instability region. And this instability region has been shown that these stars develop a photosphere, a pseudo photosphere, really thick, that will result in an intense mass loss ejection. So, what these sources are actually doing, crossing here, you don't see that. And you will only see these sources when they appear here after the gas ejected is distributed. So, the evolution proposed for this object in general is proposed by Nathan Smith. Start with all star and blue supergiant, red supergiant. You have first the initial material, one half of the initial mass, as I mentioned. Then yellow habilian, reduce these two stability regions, and then go to luminous vapor candidates and warm again. Okay, now we know more or less how this source evolves. Well, we know about the structures in terms of molecular gas. Well, the source is very nice. It's B1-SCMA, it's a red supergiant. And I had observed in regular emissions several lines. The first one was this mass by Miller, which derived this model, which has two outputs here. And this output has been confirmed by dress more recent maps, the fermetic maps of regular emission by the Fulton's on this old. And this is actually made a survey with SMA, so we have plenty of lines which show most of them these outflows. So we know that these sources are not as ADVs, as have been proposed many times, that are similar to ADVs. We have already got those, but we don't know from the rest of the subjects. Well, actually, despite, as I mentioned, the ejectors of material, only six of them have been observed in at least two CO lines. Which are this is one of the maps. Actually, same CO, there are six, mapped in CO, there are three. This is the second one that we map. We obtained this map recently. It's S2, because it's a red supergiant, and it's very rounded, as you can see. A lot of problems, but it's as rounded as an LGB would be. For instance, another map we obtained is completely different. It's also a red supergiant, it's twisted gas, and in this case, you don't see anything rounded at all. You see, this we have a big. And then you go to all of you. It's a channel match, okay? You see this curve here and curve here, which resembles to something like an hourglass with a mesh still closed, or something like this. It's about the thing we have seen in these maps. But you see, this has nothing to do with the spherical as an expert. So we start to see that we can have a spherical, visible giants, something showing outflows, like B-by-CMA as well. And then we check the profiles of the rest of the CO profile of the rest, making an idea that things are away. Actually, this set shows a really normal ADV kind of profile. also when Sydney shows kind of overloads in this source more similar to BYCMA. So we have two types of stars. Okay, we can try to look for any kind of evolutionary explanation for this. If we plot this objects in the HR diagram, see here, then we don't see anything. It's more or less at the same temperature, you cannot extract many things from that. But we have to take into account the mass has been ejected, right? The relative of the temperature, at the determination of the temperature. And for instance, if you look at the 60 micron flux collected by distance, it's more or less what we see as a round seeker, it's a logarithmic scale. You have the numbers. You see that those showing more infrared flux are those showing actually off, and I was thinking, we will see a main best gas. At first, you start, you have more infrared at 60 micron, so you have more material ejected, so that already means that these sources are more evolved. At the same time, you will expect the sources to be more hotter and look more red, due to this the extinction. While these three objects show a little infrared, so they have not much material ejected and they look rounded. So this seems to mean that what you have here is something like AGB post AGB evolution. So the less evolved, the supergiants are rounded, and as they evolve, you start to see outflows and departure from this frequency. Okay, that was for the supergiants. What we have for little hypergiants? Well, often CO maps 0 to 1, 1 to 0, and this is one FAGL 2023, and we often obtain the same for IFC and for 20. Actually, only two general hypergiants have been found to have zero emission, that is true, so the sample is not that big. FAGL 2023 shows a really rounded shape with a hole in the central parts, with a detached shell, and for IFC and for 20, as on this is more spherical like this. The parts are from that, but the bigger parts, these two lobes, this is a spherical shell. With more of these maps in CO, the LVD code, that this transfer, and we obtain, for instance, this model. This is for IS-1020. We have shown, we found two mass loss periods. Actually, this is very similar to the Friday. Central hole there, and this is the mass loss history and the temperature profiles. And we found that this model we obtained from this infrared data is able to reproduce precipitation from CO from low excitation to high excitation. CO is CO 1 to 0 to 16 to 15 from high phi and so on. We managed to fit all things. So we already count on an accurate model of the molecular emission on this source that I will show you later. We can use to extract things, interesting results on the chemistry. Also, you see that here's a gap, here's a hole in the central part of the envelope. In general, you expect SIO, for instance, to be present in these regions. The silicon gets attached into the grains really fast. So, this in general, this trace innermost regions where the dust is being formed. In this particular case, SIO is found in the outer part of the inner shell, which means this is by far what we expect to find SIO. The explanation for this is a shock. Shock, it's the grains, the silicon gets removed from the grains, and then start to form silicon. SIO, so. Okay, we've seen that for instance, these zero hypergiants are more or less rounded, right? But what happens if we look at maps at all of the molecules, for instance, HCN, which is this FAGL 2023, this beautiful rounded one. And you see that that's more or less rounded. But if you look at the details of the files, there's a peak here. This peak is more, not this more than SIO, for instance. So, in order to check where is coming this peak, when you see slice in half the emission, and we found that one half is, yes, normal, nothing special. The other one shows an excess here and a lack of emission here. The mass responsible for this lack and this excess is exactly the same. So, the interpretation of this is that in the inner regions of the envelope, we have some gas that has been accelerated. So maybe we are seeing some incipient collimation in the inner regions of the D0 hypergiant. Well, with all these things, we are quite ready. Well, as I mentioned, we see that we have a kind of AGB-AGB-like evolution in the supergiants, the toast jumper, spherical emission for spherical shapes. This is an emission, from is there, IFLS 2.3. Also, I follow the same. So, this emission is that amount of material, but this can be just explained by mass of by pressure. So, it's again at AGB like ejections. So, we have two periods two of mass ejections, AGB positive like one at the beginning of the beginning end of the super red giant phase, around the end. As a outflows, and here again it's spherical and then it's time to show some outflows or two times. This was for the search. Okay? Move forward to the chemistry. We have seen that C2O ratio is important to determine the chemistry of the dianeure, the stars and so on. But we have what we have for modern single stars. Well, as a star is larger than three solar masses, we have so called Hobolt or Banding that start to destroy the core of the star. Carbon compared to nitrogen. So, in the photosphere, what you have really is a decrease in the carbon abundance compared to oxygen, and in general it was said that massive stars would be oxygen rich. But we have to note that this increase in oxygen, relative increase in oxygen, was by means of creating more nitrogen, so maybe we'll have nitrogen-rich chemistry is something we have explored and observed. Also, we can have lines related with molecules related with this sodium neon cycle, showing those chemistry as well. And for the yellow abelians, we start with yellow, but they're hot already, some for the induced chemistry. Okay, what we have, what we know so far but already is that reverse image, as I mentioned, the best study of the green supergiant is having observed in plenty of lines, sodium chloride, amino oxides, CN, HCO plus, and so on. Since the name of the high swimming with the aero. Also, Leo has published high field observations of certain lines, with very good signal to noise, and also with PAX. So, which a survey, and show the richness of this object. For the rest of the Lusper Giants, MM1 has all these lines, but Betelgeuse only shows CO, OH, and H2O. But it's just really small, it doesn't have much material, so not very much in the lines. And for the rest of the group, those when I observe, just have low J, CO, so not much. So we thought as well, okay, let's go for the USMA, the one showing the most, which is chemistry, and try to get all we can. So we start two surveys, one with Alexa and the telescope. It's almost finished, it's 13 hours to finish, and we hi-fi all that, or all we can. And this is what, it's an example of what we have for this item, it's missing this gap here, and this gap here, see, tons of lines, and if you go to hi-fi, think you get better or worse, depending on how you think on reducing the data. It's all the same, it's just one part, it's one big two, two. And see the richness in chemistry of this kind of objects. What's important on hi-fi in particular is that it has a really nice spectral resolution. So you can disentangle these two peaks here. Say, okay, we have here these two lines, these two species. Well, to talk, this doesn't happen with PAX. PAX is really good and not disentangled with this. As we cannot disentangle with this, we have only one line in that. All these angles hi-fi have been identified for most of them. But, sorry, this is also important about the resolution, spectral resolution. With that, you can start to know things just from the light. For instance, CO is just one hole. Just taking these two CO lines, you see that, well, USMA has three components. This is the outflows and the outflows and the core. And you see that here, when you go to higher excitation, the intensity is weak, it's the outflows where they are crowded and standard parts. You also see that some lines trace only the outflows. And also have some lines like this one that is really narrow compared with the central ocean up here, which means that this line is coming from the task formation region. So we can take plenty of different things. Okay. Well, these are the lines we observe. After we identified almost a third more than 50 lines, 51 species. You can see and you have CN or many nitrogen species, oxygen as well. We'll go faster. I saw some lines we observe. CSIRO lines, CSIS lines, water. Okay, before you don't have a line, what's on the chemistry of these models? Well, I'm sitting for 20 years, but I think I don't have a line, it's really rich in molecules. So we decided to do something similar to biochemics, go for a survey, and a centimeter. First one's already finished and about to be published. And what we found is that, well, it's just not that rich in molecules, but all these ingredients are met.